Hello.
Mazel tov.
It is us, the Deep Dive Divas, back from a break, which we, upon review, never told anyone we were taking. And we wanted to say we're sorry, leaving you high and dry.
I'm not sorry.
No? When did you become a little BA? During the break?
My life motto is never be sorry. Always be tardy.
Tardy?
Show late. Late.
So we put out our last episode back in July. It is now, this episode will be releasing in November. What did you do with your summer and fall, Owen?
Man.
Well, you were in Paris for the Olympics. You were competing. Congratulations.
Yeah, I never want to see a paddleboard again.
Mm. Yeah, I mean, the way, I didn't think it could even fit in there, but.
What do you do?
I sat down in a chair and watched the leaves turn from green to kind of a greenish brown.
The clove of seasons.
Mm-hmm. Yep, the juggernaut of time marches on for us all.
Choo-choo.
Yep,
how many?
I'm marching. So, yes, we meant to say something about us going away, but we just plumb forgot to, and we're feeling pretty embarrassed about it. But we are now back in this, our third season of the show.
Oh, my God. You know what they say? Three.
They say that.
Magic number.
A slight change. You might be accustomed to hearing from us every other week. We're not going to do that anymore. We will only broadcast one new episode on the first of each month. For those of you doing the math, that is, yes, half as many episodes as we were doing before. Why would we leave you all hanging without a word from us for months and then return with a fraction of the infotainment we had given you in the past? Well, I'll tell you. It's because I'm tired. It's a lot of work to pump these out every other week.
I mean, I'm going through my seventh divorce.
The show is sucking the life out of us. Yeah. Owen can't pay any more alimony. I don't have the energy. What's that?
I hate this show.
We hate the show. Mm-hmm. And you should too. Being in the room with Owen, sucking the life out of me. Music is sucking the life out of me. I just hate it all so much. So with that being said, this episode, much like the start of our first episode of season two, is here to recap all of the wonderful things that happened to all of the artists that we have covered so far in the program. All 48 of them. Except most of them are like still dead or haven't really done anything since our last update episode. So we're only really going to cover the ones who have done anything of note. Since our last update episode, only two artists on our list have released new records. A nice change from last time when I think there were like eight new records.
Yeah.
But lots of them have done amusing or silly things, so we're going to skip through our catalog and update you on any news about our artists that we think will bring you delight or intrigue. Let us begin.
Double D, or triple D, let's get rocking.
Thank you.
I think that's a new phrase we could incorporate in the show.
Sure.
Maybe like before every five sentences.
I'm going to leave that up to you because I have to keep, I got to keep the levels going on the board. So that's going to be a you job, but I'm pleased for you and congratulations on the promotion.
And now say it. That's been a couple of sentences.
You just said, I did. What was it? Triple D. Let's get hot. What was it? Let's get rocking.
Whoa. I feel like I have so much low end.
Yeah, well,
I think my voice is just getting deeper.
It really is. Like, here, let me play a clip now from season two.
Yeah, I think they should have checked with us before.
Before they wrecked themselves.
Or maybe you should have checked with them.
I'll have my people call their people.
You gotta chickity check with the artists before they rickety wreck your
fartists.
That's when the fart sound effect would really come in handy.
Whoa.
This was like less than a year ago.
Wow.
We last left them when they announced their farewell tour, which was to start in September of 2023. This was, in a predictably lame manner, called Peace Out, the Farewell Tour. Steven Tyler was in rehab before this tour for over a month. The tour began and then stopped almost immediately. The group cited Steven Tyler shredding his vocal cords as the cause for it.
Shredding, just like the rock gods would have wanted. Keep rocking, Triple D.
Peace out. They say they will try again next year in September of 24, and a month before the tour was to begin, the band quit and said they have retired. So as of now, no more Aerosmith. I know you miss him, babe, but you don't want to miss a thing.
You don't know what you got till it's gone.
You said it.
Nero, Nero for Alabama Shakes.
In February
shake.
Of this year, 2024, Brittany Howard put out her second solo record entitled, What Now? But Brittany Howard is not an artist that we have covered on this show exclusively, so we don't need to rate it. But here's some music from it.
It's perfect to you. All I wanna do is prove it to you. All I wanna do is prove it to you.
Back in May, Brittany Howard told Entertainment Weekly in regards to a Alabama Shakes reunion, quote, I wouldn't say the door's completely closed. Sounds like she's in. This same month, a Netflix animated film entitled Thelma the Unicorn was released. Brittany Howard plays the main character in this film. Mm-hmm. Never heard of it.
I'm a unicorn.
Woo-hoo! I'm a unicorn!
Nero, Nero 6, Oxboro Hotups.
Nothing happened with this Green Day alter ego, but Green Day themselves put out a new record in January this year entitled Saviors. Again, we never did a proper episode on Green Day yet until a guest mandates that we do. So legally, we don't have to review this album. Here's some of their music.
Friend, I'll take you to a movie that we've already seen. Or sit at home and watch reruns. There's no other place I wanna be.
Nero 11, Journey.
Journey canceled their European tour dates due to Neil Schon, guitar boy, and Jonathan Cain, piano dork, continuing to sue each other. The nature of this particular lawsuit is that Jonathan Cain said that Neil Schon is abusing the band's credit cards. Rock and roll, guys.
Nero 12, Odd Future.
Lionel Boyce was nominated for an Emmy for his role on The Bear.
It's a bear impression.
He lost to Eben Moss Bacharach from The Bear. I didn't know that they nominated multiple people from the same show.
Yeah.
Feels cannibalistic.
Pretty cool.
Odd Future did not reunite at last year's Camp Flognaw. And they most certainly didn't reunite and sing Kumbaya as Owen predicted they would. There were $1 million on the line. Although I did go back and listen to the clip, and I stupidly only bet you that they wouldn't do it. I didn't get anything. I didn't get anything out of this bet.
Nero 16 Red Hot Chili Peppers.
Josh Klinghoffer, the replacement guitarist of the Red Hot Chili Peppers, was sued for wrongful death in March of 2024 after he hit a 47-year-old man with his car. Klinghoffer has been accused of, quote, negligence behind the wheel. The band, now without Klinghoffer and with John Frusciante, played the closing ceremony of this year's Olympic Games in Paris, where Owen was in the background waving his paddleboard.
Yeah. Saying, oh, yeah.
You may not know this because they never talk about it, but the Red Hot Chili Peppers are from a place called California, specifically Los Angeles, which is where the next Summer Olympics will be held come in 2028.
Do not love the vacation. It's a love.
They claim they are working on a new album
Nero 17, Taylor Swift.
She's older than 17.
This brings us to, that's good. This brings us to the first record that was made by one of our alumnus. Back on April 19th of this year, Taylor Swift released The Tortured Poets Department. This was written while she was out on the Eras tour following her last record, Midnights. She actually announced this album's existence at the 66th Grammys in February when she was accepting the Grammy for Best Pop Vocal Album. Could you imagine accepting a Best Album of the Year award and then be like, by the way, I'm going to use this opportunity to promote my next record. Some people are so successful.
It's unfair.
I don't know if it's unfair. It's just unbeknownst to me. Jack Antonoff and Aaron Dessner produced this album. Initially, it was 16 songs long. 2 hours after she released it came a follow-up album called The Anthology, which was made up of a double record consisting of 31 tracks.
So I'll start off by saying I hate Jack Antonoff. Mm-hmm. I hate his side project, Bleachers. I hate Bleachers.
You hate Fun?
Yeah, I don't like Fun.
I don't really like Fun either.
I don't like the guy. He looks like a Muppet.
Yeah, so what did you think of the album?
I'll say, oh, Captain, my Captain, I didn't like it. I didn't like it.
Why not?
It was just boring. I did like they had a song called Fortnite. I touched you. Respect to all my gamers.
Sure.
Respect.
So Fortnite features Post Malone, someone who I'm not really knowledgeable of his own material, but I think Fortnite is the best track on this record. And I also think Levi's Jeans is one of the best tracks on Beyonce's Cowboy Carter, also out this year. So to my knowledge, I couldn't name a single Post Malone song to you, but I know he's great when he's featured on other people's records. What did you give this album? On a scale of 1 to 10.
I didn't take time to rate it. Probably give it a Florida out of 10. Also, some of these song names besides Fortnite. I don't want to make anyone mad, but I just didn't really like it. And that's not like, this isn't like, I hate Taylor Swift. You know what I mean? That's not what this is.
You just didn't like the record.
I just didn't like the...
I thought a lot of people, especially with the 31 track release, felt kind of fatigued with Taylor Swift, especially because Midnights was just out the previous year.
I like some songs of Midnights.
So I think it was like oversaturation for a lot of people. I generally like the whole album. Again, a 31 track album is kind of challenging for me. I really did like the 16 track cut. So I gave this a 4 out of 10, which means, you know, for me, generally 1 in 3 songs I liked a whole lot. This album tops the charts around the world. On our own Billboard 200, it sat atop at number 1 for 15 weeks, her most ever, and she held the 14 top spots on the Billboard Hot 100 simultaneously. Critics generally really like this record, though some found the anthology just too darn long.
Yeah.
Some horrible things happened around Taylor Swift this year, much of which I wasn't aware of. The first I was. There was a shooting in Kansas City after the Kansas City Chiefs had won the Super Bowl. And at the ensuing Super Bowl parade, 33 people were wounded. One was killed. Taylor Swift donated $100,000 to that woman's family. During July of this year, three children were stabbed to death in a dance studio that was holding a workshop for children to dance to Taylor's music. That same month, a stalker sent death threats to Taylor Swift and her boyfriend, this guy Travis Kelce.
Is he the basketball player?
He's Beardman. In August, ISIS planned to attack the venue in Vienna where Taylor Swift was bringing the Eras tour for 3 weeks. All of the shows that were canceled. And the plot was foiled, so no attack was carried out. Fugees were set to embark on an international tour with Miss Lauryn Hill playing a separate set as well. This was canceled without comment. Miss Lauryn Hill later said that they canceled the tour due to low ticket sales, which she blamed the media for after they descended upon her when her last tour was partially canceled. Some things never change.
Every city, every ghetto, more like every city, you get no show. I'm not coming. I think it's time to talk some sports. I'm flexing, by the way.
Yep.
Kind of Pat McAfee style.
Gosh. So much athleticism.
We should get him on the show. Pat McAfee?
Sure.
Stephen A. Smith. So we're introducing a new segment this season. Basically, I'm going to watch a movie. I'm going to talk about that movie. It's probably going to be a movie everyone else has seen. I'm just seeing for the first time. Sometimes it's not the movie I'm seeing for the first time. Maybe it's a rewatch. In this case, it was a movie I saw for the first time. Today we're talking about the Zach Braff and Natalie Portman movie.
Garden State.
Garden State!
New Jersey. Alright, so basically I'll give you a little brief on the movie. It's Zach Braff. Famous in shows like Scrubs, Natalie Portman, Star Wars.
Basically. Go on.
story, it's basically like a coming of age, almost love indie film. Came out 2004. I forget who it was directed by. I'm going to skip over a lot of stuff. You should just go watch the movies. He's a girl, Natalie Portman. He's living with his friend. They get together. He starts to like each other and stuff. And then, yeah, it's like a coming of age movie. You know, it's fun. It's good. I'll give this movie 8 out of 10. I liked it a lot. So that was good. Next time I'll be doing The Ring.
So if you want to follow along to NPR Sports Edition, please watch The Ring. By December 1st. Actually, they got a month. They got a month now.
Yeah, you got a month.
And nothing says you should gather around the turkey corpse and
watch
wearing
The Ring.
Pilgrim hats with your family and watch The Ring. This is the second group to put out an album since our last updates episode. Tell me what you thought about their newest installment. The Maybe
Boo.
Man.
Okay. Oh, I'm sorry.
All right, well, use your words, boy.
Me not likey. I couldn't find one track I liked on this. I'm sorry to all the AJR fans. Hey, but if you're listening to the podcast, who's at Disney World?
So you're saying only people who like Disney like AJR?
No.
Also, is it a bad thing to be at Disney? I mean, I like the joke. I like the joke. I just don't get...
If all the AJR fans are listening to the podcast, then who's drinking the skim milk? Right?
Did you listen to this record? I did. You're not really offering any insight and commentary on the actual album
because
itself.
There's nothing.
You're just making fun of. On their fans.
I didn't even write a note about any song. It was just too annoying.
I like this album. I gave it a 5 out of 10. This is the band's fifth record. Again, it's entitled The Maybe Man, which I don't know if you heard Zone was yelling over it.
Maybe.
It was to be released on November 10th of 2023, and they embarked on an arena tour 2 days before this. The tour sold super well, selling out Madison Square Garden twice, and routinely required them to be moved to larger venues. This is their first record as a part of a major label. they signed to Mercury Records for this album. AllMusic gave it a 3.5 out of 5 stars. There are over 40 contributing musicians on this record, which is remarkable because if you look at their past history, most of their records are made by like the three of them, maybe a couple of handful of friends. To me, I find it interesting that there are so many musicians on it. I also find the move to a major label interesting because to me, this does not, in terms of sound, sound really any different from the stuff they were making in their living room. And that's one of the main things that really drew me to this band is how truly indie they are and how they produced all their records themselves. I thought that was really admirable and one of the things I really liked about it. Again, I don't really see any difference in sound here. Lots of the songs on this record are about existential dread and the fear of death, which makes sense as their father's health devolved throughout its recording and ultimately resulted in his death just before the album was released. So I think that was very much on their mind. This record holds what I think is my new Yummy Yummy song by them entitled Hole in the Bottom of My Head, which is a jaunty number. I think it sounds quite different from a lot of the other things that they've done. It doesn't really have that big like anthemic sort of sound.
There's a hole in the bottom of my brain. If I make money, the hole goes away. Now there's a thing made of gold in a home that I own from a song.
I think they were really in their sad emotions, and I think it came to the top, and I think it works for them.
Each episode, we like to highlight the up-and-coming work of a discography-developing diva. Today, that is Anna Hudson. Anna Hudson is a singer-songwriter and producer born and raised in the perfectly small town of Winston-Salem, North Carolina. Howdy, y'all. Hudson draws inspiration from the vast amount of musical influences of the North Carolinian music scene, unafraid to immerse herself in different soundscapes such as folk, rock, and electronica. She compares her sound to the likes of Be a Bad Doobie, Bon Iver, and Faye Webster. Anna is currently a senior at Berklee College of Music in Boston, again, howdy y'all, studying production, songwriting, and the music business. It is now time to get down, girl. Go ahead, get down with Anna Hudson and her track, The Way It Ends.
Don't you love to play pretend? Draw your truth in the sand. Don't you love to forget? Don't you love to regret? Was the tea too much? Was the train ride long enough? Oh, I'd love to begin. But don't you love the way it ends? Don't you want? Don't you wanna tell nobody? Without words it can't exist. So don't you call it what it is. Don't you love it? Don't you love the way it ends? Don't you love the way? Pick
try and can't forget it. Keep your secrets, who'd believe them? If they knew, I'd be embarrassed. Picture perfect, worth a fortune. Take the path of least resistance. Sunday morning, rain is pouring. Oscar winning, best performance. Picture perfect, fucking worthless. Lying next and no commitment. Every weekend, you and me go dancing in the square. Go back and begin. Or just ignore it again. 'Cause I'm afraid to watch it end.
You can hear more from Anna Hudson. Visit our shop and social media pages, contact us, view our citations, and so much more by using the links in this episode's show notes.
024 Miley Cyrus.
I'm shocked by this, but Miley Cyrus is being sued by Bruno Mars.
Oh my God.
His lawyers are arguing that Flowers is ripping off When I Was Your Man.
I should have bought you flowers. I can buy myself flowers.
I have no evidence for this, but I just kind of assume they were friends. They got famous like at the same time, were famous for the same stretch of time, ran in similar circles. Maybe I'm wrong on that, but I was kind of surprised. I'd assume that they would be collaborators in some capacity or something. Flowers won Record of the Year and Best Pop Solo Performance at the 66 Grammys as well when Taylor announced the Tortured Poets Department. Miley appears on the track Two Most Wanted on Beyonce's Cowboy Carter, speaking of that.
I love that album.
I'll be your shotgun rider till the day I die. Smoke out the window, flying down the 405. Yeah, I'll be your backseat, baby, driving you crazy anytime you like. Whoa, I'll be your shotgun rider till the day I die.
And speaking of appearing on things, she is on the Talking Heads tribute album produced by A24 Music, which I didn't know the film production company had a music label as well, entitled Everyone's Getting Involved, a tribute to the Talking Heads, Stop Making Sense. She performs Psycho Killer.
Can't seem to face up to the facts. I'm tense and nervous and I can't relax. I can't sleep 'cause my bed's on fire. Touch me, I'm a real live wire. Psycho killer, yes, you see.
They played the NPR Tiny Desk in August.
Oh, welcome, and Devo.
They did the most Devo thing imaginable and played none of their hits. Instead, they played a set list of It Takes a Worried Man, which they recorded for the film Human Highway decades ago. They said they haven't played the song in 4 decades. It was then followed up with Praying Hands, which is one of my favorites, but it's not a hit. And then Come Back, Joni. They are such an annoying bunch of boys.
Those little hats.
Assume the position. Go into doggy submission.
035 Soul Coughing.
The band, against all odds and expectations, reformed. The reason I'm stressing how unlikely that was is that Mike Doty seems to hate his band with every fiber of his being. He wrote as much in his several memoirs. The small tour ran between September and October and included them playing Super Bon Bon on Jimmy Kimmel Live.
Bon Bon.
This is the 30th anniversary reissue of their album Ruby Room, here with the song Super Bon Bon, Soul Coughing.
Some hands motioning to rise, to rise, to rise. Too fat, fat, you must cut lean. You gotta take the elevator to the mezzanine shop. Change in the song, super bomb bomb, super bomb bomb, super bomb bomb. Too fat, fat, you must cut lean. You gotta take the elevator.
036, the Postal Service.
The band just announced, now in September, that they would disband indefinitely following their current reunion tour, on which they are supporting Ben Gibbard's own Death Cab for Cutie, so he's double duty that night. To date, their last show was at HF Festival in Washington, D.C. on September 21st.
If the Postal Service fans are listening to this episode, then who's delivering the mail?
That's a good question.
044, Weird Al Yankovic.
He put out his first single in 2 years entitled Pokemania. It's another mashup.
Yeah.
And reminded the world that he will never make a full album again. I just got tickets to see him next July.
Oh, really?
At the Man Music Center.
I was thinking about it. It's at the Man. That's great.
I can buy myself flowers.
Pink Martini.
I could go for a martini right now.
Heidi!
How are you?
This is the Deep Dive Divas calling, the podcast where we review every artist that we've ever talked about on the show and then share our findings with you. How are you this evening?
I'm great. I love your podcast.
Thank you so much. And we haven't even paid you all that much to say that. Thank you.
That's right.
Pink Martini put out a new song with the 93-year-old Mamie Van Doren called I Told Ya I Love Ya, Now Get Out. Could you give us in one word or less a review of this song?
Why?
Thank you so much for being on the program this evening, Heidi.
You're welcome.
All right. Bye.
See you, Heidi.
Bye.
She's great.
What a nice lady.
Yeah, the song sucks. Mamie Van Doren was an actor, singer, and model throughout the 1950s and 1960s. She was called one of the three M's alongside Jane Mansfield and Marilyn Monroe.
Wow.
There may be times when I need you, there's no doubt. Baby, now you're something I can do.
That's it, folks. We will be back next month with an all-new episode, and this is a big one that we're very excited
big
for.
One.
We hope you have a pleasant and professional month. I think that's our new sign-off.
I feel like it's kind of stepping on the toes of my new catchphrase, don't you think?
Your what?
My new catchphrase.
What's your new catchphrase?
You already forgot it.
Oh, yeah. Hey there, it's Triple D. Cowabunga, dudes.
Triple D. That's rock. That's what it was. I feel like it's kind of stepping on the toes of that.
Well, how about this? I'll let you have final words.
Well, so. No, I don't think it's cool. I don't think it's cool for you.
Well, I'm saying
that.
I'm saying I'll say.
No, I don't know if I want to do the show anymore.
Well, I'm just saying.
I feel like you're being like a real. Like a. I don't want to say the word. But. Knucklehead.
Well, all I mean to say is that I'll say this catchphrase and then you can close out with your catchphrase. Which
yeah, but it's like once you have one catchphrase, what's the point of two?
Well, I think people will like yours better.
Well, then
mine's more appealing to the business class, whereas yours, I think, is really it speaks to the rabble rouser. The hoi polloi.
You think so?
Yeah, I think all the cool guys in the leather jackets sipping Cokes at the jukebox will like yours a lot better than mine.
That's so sweet.
So how about let's try it. You want to?
Yeah.
Okay. We hope you have a pleasant and professional month.
Good. I stuttered.